It's been a year and a half since Wings of Liberty Deathless blew up and I accidentally became a YouTuber. And as we all know, no YouTube channel is complete without a tier list. I thought it would be a fun way to conclude the series, allowing us to take a look back at everything and reminisce a bit. But how exactly do I make a tier list for my own video series? I can't rank things on traditional tier list stuff like how good the flavors are, so instead I opted to go for how memorable the missions are, how much of an impact they made on me. The goal is that I can cover the awesome missions, the memorable ones, and maybe give some personal anecdotes along the way. Because I'm working off of memory, I get to do something weird here. There are 152 combined StarCraft II and WarCraft III missions, and we only have 36 minutes and 36 seconds. So everything I don't have a great memory of, meaning the large majority of the missions, are in D tier. We're gonna skip right past them and get straight to the good stuff. So let's do what this channel does best, put way too much time into making a highly edited version of what is normally the lowest effort content on YouTube. Let's start with the Crucible. What was I even thinking here? To defend Kerrigan's Chrysalis, I ended up going for a weird spawning pool Queen Spore Crawler wall. I remember having huge troubles. Primal Ultralisk kept walking over my queens and slapping them silly. Spawning pools would die and release broodlings causing resets. It was an all-around miserable experience of a defense mission. But why? Why did I do this? I needed something else to protect my queens. Some sort of defensive emplacement. Bonus points if it were a building that could wall off instead of the spawning pools. And even more points if it could move away while injured. How did I not build spine crawlers? For the life of me, I can't remember my logic here. Why did I force myself to suffer on the Crucible when I didn't have to? Usually, I can look back and see some sort of logic with my builds. For the Crucible, I'm pretty sure I went into the mission determined to build a wall of spawning pools, and I wasn't gonna let anything stop me. The Crucible is fittingly C tier. Gates of Heck is a mission I remember because of the cheese, but also, it's just fun. Being forced to keep all 10 drop pods alive created a hectic scenario that really spiced things up. For example, there's a part where two drop pods arrive at the same time. If one of them is rescued, the Zerg immediately attacks the other, forcing me to secure both of the positions while simultaneously defending my base. It really stressed my multitasking at the time. I also love the irony of the drop pods providing me with an enormous army only to not use that army and instead cheese the final objective with nukes. Gates of Hell is a very solid C tier. By Demons Be Driven was the first time I had to make a meme ending for a video. Almost always the final mission is an epic climax to a campaign, making it a natural contender for the spot of most difficult Deathless mission. The first time this wasn't true was Heart of the Swarm Deathless, and I sort of hand-waved it away and moved on. But by the time I got to Orc Deathless, I was a lot more invested in trying to make my videos flow better. This was the sixth Deathless video I'd made. I assumed at that point that viewers had a certain level of implicit trust that if I were to hype something up to be epic, then it would be. I was very disappointed that you would give me that trust, and I decided to throw it all away as fast as possible. The idea of taking a 2-minute stroll through the park, capturing Grom inside of a Master Ball, and then walking home while listing off the 200 ways the mission is prepared to kick me in the teeth is hilarious. Nothing I said at the time was a lie. If I actually had to play the mission, it would have been miserable, but the joke is still funny to me today. This mission also has some strong nostalgia for me. I didn't own Warcraft 3 right as it came out, but my friend's older brother did. We would often watch him play through the campaign, and once my parents bought the game for me as a kid, that older brother showed me this cheese. The fact that that little memory from when I was a kid ended up helping me so many years later is really special to me. By Demons Be Driven is gonna be C tier. Honestly, most of the human campaign Deathless was a letdown. I considered not running the Warcraft 3 Deathless because the combination of the Paladin, Priest, and ranged firepower made the missions too easy. Thankfully, the final mission Frostmourne gave me enough hope to keep going. The combination of the game starting me with a large, suboptimal army and the AI often attacking with brutal forces got me really excited. Doubling up the excitement was the fact that I had to micro against the enemy attack waves and control Arthas' squad at the same time. I wish there were more RTS missions that had both a base building and no build segment at the same time. It does a great job at upping the stakes. With heroes doing something else, the early segments of a mission can actually be hard for once. The early parts were good, but after getting Frostmourne was my favorite. Heading across the map and straight into Mal'Ganis' base, only to find out that he had the exact same idea, things blew out of control quickly. I had to drop my plan and start thinking on my feet. The fact that the AI destroyed my base, found my last buildings and just didn't want to fight them, it felt like a sequence of one in a million events to get out of that. It was awesome. I also love the fact that Murden died during a cinematic in the mission because I get to be pedantic. Because Blizzard is deathly allergic to originality, they eventually retconned Muradin's death and decided that he was knocked unconscious and lost his memories. They did this because they wanted to use him in World of Warcraft, so technically he didn't die. If Blizzard insists on ruining their stories by making death a temporary status condition, I am absolutely going to abuse it. Frostmourne is C tier. No build missions are generally a reprieve in Deathless runs. They're almost never timed and involve small squads of elite units. 4 Ire flips this on its head, giving the player hundreds of Protoss units to fight against even more Zerg. I really enjoyed the juxtaposition between the mission's intended design of here's the F2 button, go murder everything, and the slow, calculated progression required in Deathless. The large enemy forces combined with my limited unit count felt like every fight had to be taken tactically. It felt a little bit like a puzzle. Fun but not world-shattering lands 4 Ire right in C tier. By all means, the Devil's Playground should have been a D tier mission, for didn't leave a mark. Make Marauders and Medics to tank, War Pig Mercenaries to fight air, and mine 8,000 minerals. What makes this mission so special is that it's the first time I screwed up in a video. I always run Deathless with the rule of saving allies whenever possible, and there are 26 allies to rescue on the map. And I just didn't do that, leaving a group of Tosh's boys to rot. Fortunately, the comments section did not let me miss this, and I managed to save all the boys in an FAQ video that I recorded to stall for time while I was making Heart of the Swarm Deathless. Nowadays, that sort of mistake would have never happened. I have a Twitch audience who would never allow me to do something so foolish. But back then, I really felt bad about leaving these boys to die. Devil's Playground is C tier. Destiny of Flame and Sorrow is a mission that is forgettable to many, but to me, it's the polar opposite. Many people were malcontent at the tale of how I completed this mission. They said it was unbearable, saying that I should have taken pause to explain things better. But after bearing the brunt of their scrutiny, I realized that if I pandered to their whims, it would have led this channel to a grisly fate. I'm qualified to make these videos the way that I want, and I for one think my description was irksome. A Destiny of Flame and Sorrow is C tier. It stands for Cub. When I started the Deathless series, I didn't have a huge amount of experience with the campaigns. I had played them through on brutal difficulty and gotten all the mastery achievements, but that's about it. Going into it, I was a goody two-shoes, a straight-up macro player. That didn't last long. Cutthroat is the first time I tasted that delicious, delicious cheese, and I was instantly hooked. Instead of collecting 6,000 minerals to pay off Mirahan, I blitzed Colonel Orlan. I made some ghosts, got some nukes, and blew away his command center from the low ground. This isn't even close to the most exciting gimmick I've ever done, not even on this mission, but everybody's first time is special. Fitting for the name, Cutthroat is C tier. Boss monsters are difficult to get right in RTS, and Heart of the Swarm did an admirable job at attempting them. The majority of Waking the Ancient is pretty boring. Fight enemies, collect meat, and feed the big boy. But the boss fight is where things got interesting. Brack hits so freaking hard. This fight took me a couple of tries, with him blasting 70 Mutalisks out of the air in 2 shots on my first attempt. I finally ended up on a dive bomb strategy, where I weakened him twice with Kinetic Blast and then blitzed him with everything before he could attack the same target twice. This tactical boss fight makes the mission memorable, but the first 25 minutes being unremarkable means that C tier is the best that I can give. I also later learned that Kerrigan can kite Brack forever, she's just faster than him on creep. Looking back at this, I'm not sure how I didn't figure that out. With that in mind, Awaken the Ancient lands firmly in C tier. A Song of Frost and Fire is peak Reforged. The fact that Blizzard ruined their own product so dramatically that it took what should have been the most difficult Deathless mission ever and made it a joke, what should have been the culmination of everything I had learned over the past year, but instead ended up being a mess that breaks over an unnecessary feature that nobody asked for? I couldn't ask for a more fitting end for Warcraft 3 Reforged. There have been a lot of questions about why I decided to run Reforged instead of the non-Reforged version of the game. It wasn't because it had shinier graphics or to get drama about it in the comment section for engagement. It's because when I bought the game, I was pissed. It sucked. They actively and intentionally made the experience worse. And I finally had a platform to not just complain about it, but to show people why it was so bad. If you avoided buying Reforged, I would love to hear from you in the comments. If my video saved even a single person from wasting their money on that garbage, it will have been all worth it. A Song of Frost and Fire lands firmly into C tier. The Lord of Outland is special to me for 2 reasons. The first being the culmination of the insane level of planning that I needed for the campaign. After being humbled by the Sentinel's Deathless, I decided that the Frozen Throne campaigns were not something I could approach without meticulous planning. Before setting foot into the first Blood Elf mission, I had the entire campaign planned from top to bottom. Not just strategies or army compositions, but down to the level of every individual item's use for all four heroes. The Lord of Outland, and more specifically the featured Mana Stone, is the culmination of that effort. Sometimes in life, when you put a ton of planning into things, it still goes awry. Everything falls apart and you have to start from scratch. But on that day, I worked hard, I planned hard, and it made everything easy. That is a great feeling. But there are a few things in life that have an even greater feeling. Namely, getting to use these imbalanced Naga Royal Guards against the AI for once. Get wrecked, Magtheridan. C tier for becoming the new Lord of Outland. I love meme units. Useless ones like the Predator, Destroyer, and Firebats hold a special place in my heart. They remind me of toddlers. They try so hard, but they can't do anything useful. And nothing makes me happier when memes become dreams. So of course, I have a soft spot for Hamburger of Oblivion. Hybrid Dominators were the nemesis of Legacy of the Void. Their powerful Plasma Blast and Psionic Storm greatly limited my strategies, and Hamburger of Oblivion is where they're most powerful. I didn't have the superpowered tools the Protoss received later in the campaign. Even with the famously imbalanced Narazim Dark Templar, I was getting thrashed. And then, out of nowhere, a hero arrived to save me. The Avenger Dark Templar. The Avenger has the ability to teleport home instead of dying once per minute. This unit is generally considered overpriced for what you get, but on this mission, it was wonderful. It was the only time in a Deathless run where I could charge past the enemy defenses with zero worries. So of course, I never used it again. And that's gonna land Harbinger of Oblivion right into C tier. It's pretty rare in a challenge run when I get to use the giant monsters of death, so I get excited when I can. The return to Northrend was a short and sweet solution to a mission that I was dreading. It's very weird to me that the mission allows the player to access Saffron and turn him into a Frostwyrm before getting a base. The map design meticulously removes every other way to get to the end of the mission before clearing the outpost and constructing the base that activates the two enemies. This mission absolutely was going to be one of those head scratchers that I didn't have a good answer for if this cheese didn't work. Return to Northrend is another C. Balancing the scales was memorable for two reasons, one beautiful and one horrible. Let's start with my dread. This mission is where the Naga Royal Guard decided it was going to ruin the next 6 months of my life. These stunning, AoE-ing, trident-wielding jerkfaces live rent-free in my nightmares, and I'm not ashamed to admit it. The repeated, relentless slaughter of my forces, taking hours to figure out every piece of the mission, learning the terrain, attack patterns, and base structure perfectly, only to be chain-stunned by a Royal Guard and sent back to square one, is not something I will forget soon. But cutting through the darkness that was this mission is one beacon of light. I made a friend. This mission is the first time that the RTS YouTuber Jay Barino wandered into my stream, and we've been fast friends ever since. The two of us, along with our friend Synergy, ran through all of the evil difficulty StarCraft II three-player campaigns together, and it was a blast. If you want to check out those VODs, you can do so on his YouTube channel. We also had a 3v3 team for a while, played some arcade games together, and he even appeared on both episodes of StarCraft Jeopardy I ran. Balancing the scales gets a nice happy C. Welcome to the Jungle will always stand out in my memories of this run. It was the first time a mission was actually hard. The previous missions weren't always easy peasy, but generally the solution to any given problem was just micro better and stop making Marines. The Protoss on Welcome to the Jungle were scary. The combination of flyers who ignore my bulky units, Colossus who deal massive area damage, and Psystorms who can end a run in seconds really stepped things up a notch. The only way I could take the mission was with a network of bunkers guarding each of the choke points, farming enemies as they moved onto the map. The only reason that this mission wasn't absolutely miserable is that for some reason the Colossus don't have extended thermal lance. If I couldn't hit them from the comfort of my defenses, it would have been an extra level of crazy. Welcome to the Jungle is B. I mentioned earlier that I was considering not making Warcraft 3 Deathless because the human campaign was just so boring. I couldn't figure out what to talk about. Frostmourne's weirdness convinced me to make the video, but I still needed to add some spice to the run to make it less of a slog. Dissension is special to me because it's the first time I felt comfortable trying to show more personality on a run. I'd done jokes and gags before, but rewriting an entire mission script to completely reframe it, turning Arthas from betraying his men and sinking their ships to a safety inspector with his army of government contractors, that was a whole new level. It's absolutely something that I'd do in real life, but it takes time to be comfortable enough making videos to actually put that personality on screen. And it's pretty scary when you know that it's something that's gonna be pretty weird. People absolutely judged me for it, and I can only hope it was in a positive way. Dissension is gonna be a B. Enemy Within is the epitome of a puzzle mission. It was really fun to figure out. The first time I played through the mission, I spawned all the Zerglings I could during phase 1, cleared through the stuff just fine, and upon reaching the second segment, realized I couldn't fight anything. The Protoss would spawn too quickly, and I would die. I had to go back and slowly reduce my Zergling count to figure out what the bare minimum I could finish the first segment with was. That was really neat. I love Enemy Within. I think it's one of the best non-standard StarCraft missions, but I always found it really weird that a newborn random queen could spawn an infinite number of units. Deathless capping me at 8, then 15, and finally 30 supply made the mission feel much more realistic. I know that Niadra had a big lunch that day, but not enough to spawn 51,685 Zerglings. It's a shame that Niadra was killed off in a book, so we're not going to be able to see more of her. Enemy Within is B tier. The Brothers Stormrage is special for two different reasons. The first is the insane level of planning that was necessary to beat it. The undead are ridiculous on this mission, and defending two bases at once while microing Illidan at the same time is a lot. Never before had every single movement been so tightly choreographed. Not just items and not just build orders, but exact movements and ability use planned to the perfect detail. This planning was essential for success here, but the item transfer was critical for the Blood Elf campaign as well. On Gates of the Abyss, when Illidan barely survived the passive damage while channeling at the last portal, that was the health regeneration from the Shadow Orb. This saved me in more ways than I can count, and many that I probably don't know and never will. The second reason this mission is important to me is that it reinvigorated my desire to do Deathless content. Ruins of Dalaran, which we'll talk about later, really took the wind out of my sails. The feeling of gratification I got from properly planning and executing this mission reminded me of what a joy these runs can be. These Brothers Stormrage are going to find themselves in B tier. When I was editing Legacy of the Void Deathless, I had a problem. Starting with Spear of Adun, almost a third of the missions in the campaign basically had the same description. From a gameplay perspective, they're diverse enough, but when actually explaining them, it's so obvious they had one formula that they just kept reusing. I was stressing about this on the GiantGrantGames Discord, asking for advice on how to properly differentiate all these missions. It was then that somebody had a wonderful idea. Why not just use the same description every time? And thus, the super unique missions were born. I'm a big fan of jokes that aren't disruptive. One thing I hate on YouTube is the tendency for creators to be very pushy with their jokes, often using loud sound effects to warn the viewer that this is now the time for the funny. Please laugh. When the joke is actually funny, it works, but when it falls flat, it's really annoying. It makes me happy that people are able to enjoy these jokes that are slightly more subtle, for YouTube standards at least. The type of gag that hopefully doesn't take too much away from your experience if it's not your thing. Spear of Adun and all of its friends are going to be in B tier. Warcraft Reforged sucks. Not just because it took a good product and made it worse, but because its colossal failure most likely means that Warcraft 3 will never get the resurgence that I think it's capable of. That made me frustrated, and Silvermoon is where I finally felt comfortable enough to vent my frustration. They took an iconic Warcraft mission, the campaign's climax for a character who is still important in Warcraft today, and replaced it with nonsense. I try to make my videos fairly focused on the topic, and I try not to bring in controversial subjects or topical things. I try to stay PG-13 and all that jazz. I want my videos to be a pleasant experience that don't evoke negative emotions like the rest of the internet seems to thrive off of. But at the same time, Reforged was so bad. It's a scam. When I was making the Deathless series, I was legitimately afraid that I was going to accidentally make the game look good. Which, looking back on it, is probably not something a mortal like me has the ability to do, but I knew that I had to be honest about my feelings. In the larger scope of things, it wasn't groundbreaking criticism. But at the time, I was deathly afraid of stirring the pot, and this was the first time that I did it. Silvermoon is gonna land right in B tier. Boss fights in RTS are generally really bad. Supreme was a mission all about boss fights, and it's actually pretty good. During the Supreme boss fights, Deathless was a game changer. Most of the time, the easy way to play the mission is to micromanage Kerrigan while the rest of your forces get hit by area damage and eventually die. Now that I had to work with a pretty considerably sized army, the area attacks of the primal leaders became much more frightening. It added an extra level of depth to the mission that made it really fun. Supreme is B tier, which is also the first letter that Zervan starts with. The first mission of most campaigns tends to be a little bit underwhelming. The enemies are easy, the player units are relatively good, unless they're Zerglings, and there isn't much of a puzzle to solve. Landfall was a fantastic exception to that trend. Not because of my units, but my allies. The allied Tauren, who are specifically scripted to die to centaurs, need saving, and I was shocked when I managed it. Clipping healing totems through trees to pull centaur out before the Tauren spawn is something I was pretty proud of figuring out, even if I was just trying to heal the cows. This was neat, but the icing on the cake was the fact that during the final defense segment, all of the Tauren that I saved tried to rush in and help me. Did they do very much? Not really, but that's not the point. Despite their failings, Landfall is going to be a B. This next spot is actually for three missions. The Dark Lady, Dreadlord's Fall, and A New Power in Lordaeron. These are the three Sylvanas missions in Frozen Throne, and were insanely hard. Basically, everybody agreed it was fine to use Possession for the Banshee to mind control the Legion's overpowered enemies, which is how you're supposed to win all three of these. But I was being a bit of a masochist, and decided that it didn't count. I even lied and told Twitch that I ran a poll and people just didn't want to see it, just so I could add a little bit to the challenge. It was insanely painful, but I'm glad that I did it. I find it funny how similar these three Dreadlord brothers really are. More so than Blizzard ever could have really intended. Verimothros was trapped inside of a box, causing his attack waves to charge in headfirst instead of grouping up. His forces were still too strong to fight directly, so instead I had to base trade him to win. Deathrock was similarly overpowered. I couldn't field an army that could contest his, instead I had to go mass siege tank and base trade again. And Balnazar was similar to that. I had to strategically snipe him and then rush his base, sniping the two altars so he couldn't respawn and crush me. The Dreadlord's power of Lordaeron has one single flaw, having their building sniped while they're out on business. The Dark Lady, Dreadlord's Fall, and A New Power in Lordaeron are all going to find themselves collectively in B tier. As I reached the endgame of Nova Covertop's Deathless, I started to get worried. The last few missions just weren't super engaging. For most videos, it's fine if the end isn't great, it's just how the missions are designed at times. But this was the final StarCraft Deathless mission. Even if it wasn't much, I wanted something interesting to talk about. And then, in the last few seconds of the very final mission, I found out that it was bugged. It was like Dustin Browder descended as my fairy godmother and granted my wish. The video is still pretty new, so I don't want to spoil exactly what happened, but I can't begin to express how happy I am that by some miracle, Deathless didn't end unceremoniously with mass battlecruisers spamming Yamato cannon and Nova shooting a defenseless grandma. Endgame is B tier. Phantoms of the Void is an incredibly boring mission. Make Ultralisks, make Queens, A move, and win. It's just that easy. So why is it on the list? I had to do this mission 4 separate times. When I was editing the video, I realized that I had used Stukov's Spawn Infested Terran ability thoughtlessly in the initial no build segment. Wanting to correct this, I opted to do it again. During the redo, nearly at the end of the mission, my game crashed, which is actually pretty rare for StarCraft 2. Okay, fine. I'll do it again. After finishing, I realized I forgot to start my recording again. So I got to do it for a 4th time. Phantoms of the Void is B tier. I don't really have much to say about King Arthas, except this mission is so freaking hard. It's genuinely one of the hardest missions in any Blizzard RTS, any RTS in general. Seriously, it's harder than any brutal StarCraft mission, even when you can lose units. The management of 3 bases at once with an easy loss condition, and you have to attack at the same time, it's absurd. I spent so long figuring out how the attack patterns worked on this accursed mission. I was legitimately afraid I would be stuck here forever. The fact that I managed this was, as far as I'm concerned, nothing short of a miracle squared. King Arthas is firmly in B tier. One thing that stood out in Legacy of the Void was the drastically increased number of allies in missions. They're largely absent in Wings of Liberty and Heart of the Swarm, making the ally saving rule pretty easy. Protoss just have more friends than Terran and Zerg, I guess. Of course, in Deathless, friendship is just a fancy way to say jail. And the first mission I had to lock up my allies was Brothers in Arms. Both Jim and Valerian have to be cooped up behind a wall of pylons while I force my way through the mission, for their own safety. I was initially concerned that it would be an absolute pain to keep them both alive because they couldn't attack, but it turns out they both keep producing forever, easily going past the normal 200 supply limit. anything that gets near their base is vaporized. It's pretty great. If you're ever looking for a bit of fun, try walling Jim in just like I did in that video and then wait for about 30 minutes. Bust him open and watch the carnage. The absolute madness of 400 supply Jim Raynor is a sight to behold. I 100% recommend giving it a try. Brothers in Arms is B. A Dark Covenant is the first time that I broke the AI completely and utterly. At this point, it's become a staple of my arsenal, but back then, it was a completely new experience. By stopping the initial onslaught from dying or killing my base, the game was eternally stuck in an inactive state, allowing me to slowly and steadily eliminate what would otherwise have been a ridiculous base. A Dark Covenant finds itself in B tier. Some would say that you're not a real challenge runner until you hit a frame-perfect trick. If that's true, then conviction is when I became a real challenge runner. The majority of the mission was a breeze. That's why I went here before heading to Skygear Station. I wanted to get that nice Kerrigan power boost from the mission before heading to the endgame. What a mistake that was. Upon reaching the end, I was greeted with the most annoying thing in any Deathless mission, Zerglings being spawned directly into combat, in range of Marines and siege tanks. Ugh. The only way I could save them was with a perfect cast of Wild Mutation, shielding them so that they could burrow out of harm's way. But that wasn't enough. I found that I also had to revert my save to the previous mission, clear all the way through Skygear Station first, and then return so that Ultralisks would spawn, soaking the fire. Otherwise, the Lings would die before they could burrow anyway. With all that said, Conviction is going to be our very first A tier. I want you to imagine being Grant from 2020. You just finished Deathless All In, the hardest challenge you've ever done in gaming. Your blood is pumping, adrenaline at its peak. You're on top of the world. Heart of the Swarm is going to be easy. And then your Zerglings can't kill the Eradicator on mission 1. Labrat started a tradition that wouldn't actually be continued in Deathless, but would become a mainstay of my other challenge runs. Disregard those lame army units. Workers are all you need. Labrat is A tier. The final undead mission, Under the Burning Sky, is bugged, and it made it so much more epic. The final attack wave is devastating. Every enemy unit on the map comes to steal Kel'Thuzad's lunch money, even the peasants. I went back and searched out some old pre-reforged Warcraft 3 videos, and the game absolutely doesn't do that. The attack waves are big, but they're not pulling the boys in anger. The mission was also the first time that I tried to pace my vocals and the music with the events on screen. I still don't know a whole lot about video editing, and at the time, this was a pretty big step for me. Under the Burning Sky was really cool and really fun, and for that reason, it gets A tier. I only quit Deathless once. I'm generally pretty tenacious with my challenge runs, but man, did Ruins of Dalaran destroy me. The Sentinels campaign was miserable all around, absolutely the bottom of my list in terms of Deathless campaigns. And this mission checks every box of awful Deathless experiences. Custom-made overtuned enemies, multiple high-level heroes who do incredible burst damage, 5 entrances to the bases, a pathetically useless AI ally who is more of a liability than an asset, flying raids who mean that those 5 entrances is not the only way they can get in, an insane amount of defenses who can just chain stun any non-hero, effectively declaring them dead, and an objective who can only be damaged by very specific abilities, limiting strategic diversity by a ton. While it wasn't just this mission, the slow and steady draining of my hope from the absolutely awful experience that was the Nauggle Royal Guard throughout this campaign, combined with the insanity of Ruins of Dalaran, was my breaking point. After about 6 months, I did manage to rally and come back to it. And I want to give special thanks to my friend Frequent, who put in a ton of effort to help me figure out these missions, giving me the drive to get over the hump and get to the Blood Elf and Undead campaigns. Eventually, we figured out that the rescuable Paladin was the key to victory. While Margoth the Defender himself can't fight, he could enable Malfurion, who is one of the few units that could. The MA boys rode out and died a lot. Fortunately, this mission is like 4 minutes long, so fully resetting doesn't take very much time, even if it involves rescuing Margoth quite a bit. I don't like giving it a high rating, but the Ruins of Dalaran absolutely earned this A tier. During the Orc campaign is when I really started to get cocky about this whole challenge run thing. I could do what the video says in the title, sure, that would be fine, but why settle on delivering what I promised and not waste hours and hours of my life doing something that nobody asked for? So I decided to kill Cenarius without getting fell orcs. In addition to the hours of preparation, trial, and error that this took, Cenarius himself took over 5 real-life minutes to kill. There were multiple Deathless missions that took less time than this single fight. It was insane, and I'm really proud of myself for having the audacity to do it. What I didn't show in the video is that I actually had to do the fight twice. This is because after I killed the demigod, I didn't notice that the Night Elves had breached my base. They killed a peon during the fade to black, and I had to redo the entire thing over again. For all of that effort, the Hunter of Shadows is obviously A tier. I don't want to talk about Essence of Eternity, which is probably why it's so far up here on the tier list. This mission was brutal in an unfair way. I doubt we'll ever know exactly what causes it, but I was experiencing an incredibly weird phenomenon while playing this mission. While I was being attacked on multiple sides, the side I was watching would always hold, and the side that I wasn't would get broken. This was the case even if I was just passively observing, not interacting with the game outside of moving the camera. My working hypothesis is that the game doesn't actually play out at the full frame rate when it's processing things off screen. Instead, it plays off screen stuff at maybe 15 or 30 FPS instead of 60. This would lead to more instances of higher burst damage, increasing the odds that a missile turret or bunker would be broken before it was repaired. Either that or it's quantum theory and observing the battle directly changes it. One of the two. Essence of Eternity is gonna find itself in A tier. The Night Elf Deathless video was, without a doubt, the worst video I've ever made. At least, until the day before it came out. When I initially released the early access version to my patrons, the feedback was pretty consistent. It was bad. It had no coherent plot, the missions weren't particularly interesting, and the ending sucked. They were right. The video was bad, and I knew I had to do something to fix it. That night, I went to the final mission, Twilight of the Gods, and started poking around. There had to be a better ending than breaking Arkmon's pathing and getting him stuck in a corner. I had to kill him. After running around for hours, finding every detail of building placement, worker pathing, and army location, I figured out how to destroy the Demon Lord's base, but I still had no strategy to kill him. Just as I was about to quit, I remembered the mercenary camps on the map and found my answer. The next day, I opened my stream with a purpose. It was time to act. Over the next hour and a half, I perfected my attack runs, blasted the undead base, and prepared my Firbolg Legion. When I took the fight, it was magical. It just worked. The Firbolg slaughtered the strongest enemy in Warcraft on their first try. Nothing in Deathless works on its first try. This was a miracle. It was at that moment that I knew how to make the video good. I closed my stream early and got to editing. I rebuilt the entire video from the ground up, re-recorded the large majority of the voice lines, and tied the narrative thread of the Firbolg through it. Time melted as I turned my worst video into something I could truly be proud of. And when I was done, my stream starts in 30 minutes. That's not good. Lost in time, I had edited for 22 hours straight. I rendered the video, put on a horrible sleep-deprived stream, released the video, and then fell asleep for 14 hours. Twilight of the Gods is without a doubt one of the biggest contenders for the top of A tier. A few months back, I held an elimination tournament for the best StarCraft II mission. All In crushed the results so hard that it wasn't even interesting. People adore this mission, and there's a good reason why. All In is hell, just as it should be. Between the absurd attack waves, Nidus worms erupting from the ground, and Kerrigan, this mission is everything you could ask for. With the opening build orders barely allowing me to skirt by, transitions into siege tanks to defend, banshees to fight the Nidus's and ghosts to engage Kerrigan, building formations to counter Razor Swarm, and tactical withdrawals to avoid implosion. There isn't just one answer to All In, but 10 that have to be working in perfect harmony to have a shot at winning. The mission is a masterpiece. There's no easy win cheese, there's no get out of jail free card, no silver bullet, it's just grit, determination, and planning. A for going all out on All In. I am a tier list purist. Nothing brings me out of the tier list experience more than someone who throws a ton of things into S tier. S is for sacred, the position that is so incredibly great that nothing can compare against it. There should only be one, at most two, entries into S tier. It's not for something that's just good or great, but has a deep emotional connection to the ranker. something that the mere thought causes an intense welling of emotion. For me, nothing under that is S tier. As I record this, I've been a full-time YouTuber and content creator for a little over a year. When I made Wings of Liberty Deathless, I was an indie game developer, solo making a turn-based strategy game, streaming to 3 to 4 viewers per day after work for fun. I had zero expectations for the video. I thought that wild success would be 1 to 2,000 views, and that would be it. I'd make the video and move on. So what exactly is the number one Deathless video? The coveted S rank. This stupid little bunker in the Outlaws changed my life. The first hurdle in Deathless. A fight that took me over 20 tries to get right. In the grand scheme of things, that's not much. The fight wasn't that bad. But looking back on it, that was the moment that I didn't quit. There was no reason for me to do a Deathless run. It was just something that we thought up randomly on stream one day. It wasn't my job. I had never done a challenge run before. But for some reason, I decided to keep going. I decided that the Bunker of Death would not best me. I decided to persist. And that decision started me down a path that has completely changed my life. Thank you for coming on this journey with me. I honestly don't know what I'm doing when it comes to YouTube or Twitch or any of this stuff. In the last year and a half, I've tried many things, succeeded in some, and failed in others. But the incredibly kind and supportive words of the community has repeatedly given me the inspiration and drive to keep making cool and fun stuff. You all have changed my life. I will continue to thank you in the only way that I can, giving all into creating new and fun content for you to enjoy. I appreciate you, and I hope the rest of your day is wonderful. Peace.